My dearly beloved in Christ, it is wonderful that we have this year the Feast of the Epiphany on a Sunday, because the Epiphany is fixed on the date of January the 6th, which at least a fairly strong tradition says that that's the exact day that the Magi came to worship the Christ child. But we don't know what year it was. It could have been even a full year after our Lord was born. The Magi came from a great distance. And we notice in the gospel it says that Herod inquired diligently the time that the star had appeared to them. And then he sent his soldiers to slay all of the boy babies who were 2 years old and under. So perhaps it was a good year or even more from the time our Lord was born before the Magi came. At any rate, as I was saying, it's wonderful that we have this year this feast on a Sunday, because many of the faithful are not able to come when the feast falls on a weekday. And on the average, it's one every 7 years that the Feast of the Epiphany falls on a Sunday. And yet, in many countries, the Feast of the Epiphany is actually a holy day of obligation. Unfortunately, it is not in our country, and so it seems that many people are not aware of the significance of this feast. It actually is a fact that at one time, and even for many centuries, the Epiphany had a higher rank even than Christmas. Because on Christmas our Lord was born, but on the Epiphany he was revealed or manifested, the word Epiphany means manifestation, to the Gentile nations. And for us, who are not members of the Jewish people, the Israelites, not descendants of the 12 tribes of Israel, that is significant, because our Lord came for all men. Now we have this in today's epistle from Isaiah, the Gentiles shall walk in thy light. And then a little later on, Isaiah has, the possessions of the Gentiles shall come to thee. On the second Sunday of Advent, the epistle is taken from St. Paul to the Romans, where St. Paul spends a lot of time quoting from various books of the Old Testament regarding the Gentiles. I will read some of that, taken from chapter 15 of St. Paul to the Romans. But that the Gentiles glorify God because of his mercy, as it is written, therefore will I praise thee among the Gentiles and will sing to thy name. And again he says, rejoice you Gentiles with his people. And again, praise the Lord all you Gentiles, and sing his praises. And again, Isaiah says, there shall be the root of Jesse, and he who shall arise to rule the Gentiles, in him the Gentiles shall hope. Now, as you know, the Jewish people were trained, it was instilled into them to stay away from the pagans, stay away from the Gentiles. In fact, that's what they called all the other nations who were not Israelites. They were the Gentiles. And they were told to stay away from them because they were so weak that they would fall into idolatry if they associated with the Gentiles. But our Lord came not just for the Israelites, the Hebrew people, but he came for the salvation of all mankind. And so that is why this feast is significant to us, that these three men, probably kings, not in the sense of a great nation, but kings of smaller tribes or smaller nations, but they came with gifts and they came to worship our Lord, and they represented all of mankind. They were called by a star and by an interior grace that helped them to understand what this star meant. This star was a unique creation of God. There have been attempts by scientists or astronomers to go back in the records and say, well, at that time there was this conjunction of three planets And it would have been quite bright, and that might have been the star. But no, it could not have been something like a conjunction of planets, because it says that the star came and stood over the place where the child was. So it had to be something even within our own atmosphere. It was a unique creation, this star. And there are different opinions about when the star first appeared. Did they see it when our Lord was born? Or did it perhaps appear even perhaps at the conception of our Lord, the incarnation? At any rate, they had to surmount tremendous obstacles to follow that star. These were wise men. They were like philosophers, and they were in expectation of the coming of a Messiah. They must have had access, perhaps, to the Jewish scriptures, and they knew that a Redeemer was promised. And they saw that star, and they said, "This is the sign of the great King." They followed the star. They must have been mocked and laughed at. They underwent many hardships in a long journey, and were finally rewarded with being able to worship our Lord, and for all we know, probably to hold him in their arms, to have the great joy of seeing the long-promised Redeemer. Now, there are different opinions or traditions. You read in different fathers of the church, different writers, different scriptural writers about these men. Some say that they went on, they preached our Lord, and they were martyred for the faith. At any rate, their relics are preserved in the Cologne Cathedral in Germany in a beautiful reliquary, and they're honored as saints. As you noticed when I was reading before Mass, the blessing of the gold, incense, and myrrh, it refers to addressing God as saying, through the intercession of thy saints, Gaspar, Melchior, and Balthasar. So Holy Mother Church has that there in her liturgy, their names, with the blessing of the chalk and of the gold, incense, and myrrh on this feast. But they are a good model for us to surmount the obstacles in our path to persevering in our faith and to reaching our destination, which is heaven. They had this long journey. And even as they came near to the Holy Land, the star disappeared. They didn't give up. They thought, well, let's go see the king of the area, Herod, in Jerusalem. And they said, where is the Redeemer? Where's the Messiah to be born? And he turned to the scribes, who were the scholars, and asked them, what does it say in your scriptures? Where is the Messiah to be born? And they said, in Bethlehem. And so he told them, well, go to Bethlehem. What always has struck me is that, as far as we know, nobody followed them. It says in the gospel that Herod was troubled, and so was all Jerusalem with him. You can imagine how the whole city was stirred up by this spectacle of these wealthy men, no doubt accompanied by many attendants, coming all this way and then coming into the city with their retinue, searching for the Messiah, and then being sent to Bethlehem. As far as we know, nobody followed them there. So they went, they persevered, and after they left Jerusalem, the star reappeared. And then it settled right over the place where the child was. So they are models to us of persevering, of overcoming hardships, of withstanding the ridicule of the world, that we might persevere in what we know is God's will for us. And persevere. We don't know how long their journey, but it must have been quite lengthy. And of course, traveling in those days without good roads, they had to experience many hardships. But they endured them in order to achieve their goal. So they are a model for us. We are also of the Gentiles. You know, it's interesting that our Lord, in his public life, did not go outside the confines of the land of Canaan, Palestine, the Holy Land, except on one occasion we have it written that he went up to the area of Tyre and Sidon, which would be what is now the country of Lebanon, north of the Holy Land. And there's only mention of one thing he did there, one miracle, and that was a woman whose daughter, I believe the daughter was possessed or something, our Lord cured this daughter. And the woman was following our Lord and asking for this cure, and he ignored her. And finally, the disciples went up to our Lord and said, "Will you send her away or something? She's just bothering us." And he finally turned to her and said, "I've only been sent to the children of Israel." And she kept begging for a cure for her daughter. And our Lord, what seems quite a put down, said, "It's not proper to give the children's food to the dogs." And she said, "Yes, Lord, but even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from the table." And then our Lord praised her and he said, "Woman, great is your faith. May it be done as you wish." And her daughter was cured. And that was the only time our Lord went outside the territory of the Holy Land. But he told his disciples to go to the ends of the earth to teach all nations. So our Lord came for all mankind. He invited, through this unique grace and through the star, the three Magi representing the Gentile nations. So even though he himself did not spend time traveling and preaching in other countries, except for that one single incident, nevertheless, our Lord came for all of us. And that is why this feast is important to us, because the coming of the Magi to worship our Lord represented all of us, all nations. We have all been called to the knowledge of the true faith. May we imitate the three Magi in persevering in living it and persevering to our destination, heaven. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost, amen.